How unique is the Earth when it comes to hosting life, and what alternative alien biospheres can we conceive of? For abiogenesis to occur, planetary chemistry is alpha and omega. The appearance of life out of non-life clearly needs a certain set of conditions and the ingredients to make it happen. And we are starting to get a pretty good idea of what that was like on the early Earth, though many details are still missing. Also, the question remains whether the early Earth is unique in this respect, or if this is more common in the universe than it seems. Apart from merely microbial alien biospheres, what would it then take to raise life to the level of multicellular complexity as happened on Earth over 500 million years ago? Could this particular event have happened sooner or never at all on other worlds with somewhat or very different conditions? How many and what kinds of alternative Earths are even possible? Well, let's try to find out, shall we? When it comes to the search for life in the rest of the universe, or even imagining the existence of an alien biosphere on some other known world, we still don't have a lot of good cards on our hands. There are just 4 terrestrial planets in our solar system, and only one of those appears to host complex life. Depending on internal and external factors, any planet tends to move towards a certain equilibrium that can be either advantageous to life or not. If we've learned anything from our neighboring planets, it's that 2 factors are paramount. First of all, a convective ion core combined with a relatively quick planetary rotation for generating a stable magnetic field. This is crucial for protecting the atmosphere against solar winds, solar flares, and cosmic rays. Second of all, an active geology with plate tectonics for sustaining a healthy carbon cycle. This too is essential for regulating the atmosphere by the mantle acting as a carbon buffer. Carbon deposits are transported down into the Earth's mantle and then gradually released again through volcanism. A planet like Mars was too small and therefore, because of its greater surface to volume ratio, was losing heat too quickly. This ground down Mars geology to a halt and with it a protective magnetic field. Venus too lost any chance for life, being in the grip of an extreme runaway greenhouse effect due to the accumulation of carbon dioxide in its atmosphere. A weak magnetic field due to slower rotation combined with more intense heat from the sun made sure that all its water was eventually boiled off and blown into space as hydrogen. Given how quickly life arose on Earth, it is not implausible that it likewise did on Venus and Mars, only for it to get snuffed out again or pushed into refugia. Methane detected on Mars may hint at life persisting deep in the underground, while potential signs of phosphine in Venus's clouds could mean life might exist there at high altitudes in the clouds. Though both these ideas remain speculative. No matter what, life, even if it does exist in these other places, would be microscopic. And the same may hold true for all the other potential candidates we've been finding so far, if they're even capable of hosting life at all. The growing number of known exoplanets is dominated by those far larger and far closer to their respective stars than Earth, because they're the easiest to detect. The regular announcements of a second Earth in the news always turn out to be disappointments. To me at least. These exoplanets that are most comparable to Earth are usually orbiting M-type red dwarf stars and are also often so-called super-Earths, that is, significantly larger than Earth. This means that their conditions would be radically different from what we're used to, so life might not even be possible there. Or could it? Let's sum up some of the most commonly proposed potential cradles for life, complex or not, starting with those most different from Earth. First of all, Titan-like worlds, exemplified by the moon in orbit around Saturn, where water is frozen into mountains and methane condensed into oceans. The question is how far life can climb up with these lower energy levels, though energy transfer is possible over a lower gradient too, and therefore complex systems could still work. Life on these planets could even be silicon-based, which is a good replacement for carbon, though it yields much more rigid molecules. Gas planets. Though gas giants like Jupiter lack a solid surface, it's conceivable to have life suspended in the atmosphere and carried up and down in convective turbulence. None other than Carl Sagan has already proposed this possibility a long time ago, together with his colleague Edwin Salpeter. You can learn more about this in my dedicated video on this topic over here. Habitable zone gas planets may offer better prospects by allowing for more liquid water in the form of clouds and rain. Venus-class worlds. Like our sister planet, these worlds, though similar in mass to Earth, are in the grip of a runaway greenhouse effect, scorching and squashing any hope for surface life. It's possible that the life that these worlds used to host in their early development persisted, but that it was forced to be suspended high up into the more temperate clouds. Hycean worlds. These are proposed temperate sub-Neptunes dominated by water and a thick envelope of hydrogen that is still shallow enough to host life. These are still largely hypothetical, but offer an enticing idea for an alternative biosphere. Life would have to deal with much higher temperatures than on Earth at around 200 degrees Celsius, which is double the boiling point of water on that scale. However, under the greater atmospheric pressure, water would remain fluid. Any life on these worlds would have to be purely aquatic, but then the higher gravity and pressure would be not much of an issue there. Water worlds. These are worlds with Earth-like atmospheres and climates, but with oceans that are so deep, there's no chance of dry land. The circulation of essential minerals would be suppressed because at those depths, water is pressurized into an ice shell around the silicate mantle. In my Proxima B video here, I propose a way for some kind of land life to be possible even there. In colder regions around their star, these worlds could have an ice shell, but as long as the oceans remain liquid underneath, life could still thrive. The icy moons in our solar system are tiny examples of these. Mars-class worlds. Terrestrial and temperate worlds too small to retain a thick atmospheric blanket and an active geology. As frozen, irradiated deserts, any life they may have hosted at the surface would be forced into the underground. Super-Earths. As rocky worlds with oceans, climates, and an atmosphere comparable to Earth, their greater mass would also give them an immense gravity. It has been ventured that those about twice as massive as Earth could actually be even more conducive and suitable for life. That is because these planets would be more tectonically active and have an even stronger magnetic field. Geographic features would be flattened though, oceans shallow, and any land life would be quite squat. Red dwarf star Earth mass worlds. These are by far the most popular prospects, but have their own particular quirks. Because red dwarfs are much cooler than our Sun, the habitable zone is in a much tighter ring around it. This means that these exoplanets are likely tidally locked. Also, in their youth, these worlds would be blasted by intense solar flares and ultraviolet radiation, because red dwarf stars are pretty violent in their early youth. So like Mars, they may quickly lose most, if not all, of their atmosphere. This is not certain though, and it's possible that these worlds retain habitability nevertheless. Since red dwarf or M-type star Earth mass worlds is a bit of a mouthful, I would like to propose the name of this class of worlds to be Erythrogean, based on the ancient Greek erythros, meaning red, and Gaia for Earth. Now, whereas the prospects of alien biospheres and all these different types of worlds may be enticing, life there will likely be very different from what we're used to, if even possible at all. If the spark of life is even ignited, it may never go beyond the microbial stage. And it may be surprising to hear that this may even apply to the erythrogean worlds. A 2018 study by Schweitzerman et al. Introduced a concept called the Habitable Zone for Complex Life, or HZCL. On Earth, we know that multicellular life was kickstarted only when oxygen levels crossed a certain threshold level. Larger-bodied animals are constrained by diffusion of this vital molecule, and when there's not enough around, it can't penetrate deep enough into its internal tissues. Earth's atmosphere had already been oxygenated for billions of years, but never quite enough for a Cambrian explosion to occur on a global scale. The study adds another factor to this, and that is the toxicity of carbon dioxide and carbon monoxide to oxygen-breathing animals. In particular, M-type, or red dwarf stars, emit lower levels of ultraviolet radiation necessary for a photolysis of carbon monoxide that then would accumulate in the atmosphere, hindering the development of aerobic life forms. Anaerobic microbes may still exist on erythrogean worlds, but you'd really do need certain levels of oxygen for large, complex, and active life forms, for as far as we know. Now, none of the categories I've mentioned so far I would want to call truly alternative Earths. Alternative biospheres, perhaps, but not like Earths. And as it stands, life on Earth is the only kind we know for certain can come into existence and evolve into multicellular forms. In order to restrict ourselves to those kinds of worlds and the kind of life that may develop there, let's define it as a distinct category of planets that are Earth-like in most respects. We'd need a different name than terrestrial, since that includes uninhabitable rocky planets as well as Earth. We could call this category terroid, after the Latin terra, thus meaning Earth-like. But an even better term would be based on the word tellus. This is another Latin word for Earth, but with a slightly different emphasis. Tellus refers to the Earth as a nourishing and fertile entity in a more symbolic sense, with a connection to the idea of the Earth as a life-giving force. So that would form a much more appropriate term for a planet that, like Earth, can support life. Unfortunately, telluroid has a different use already as a noun in the field of geodesy, that is concerned with geometrical and other properties of the Earth. An alternative could simply be telluric, although this is used as a synonym for terrestrial. A completely novel word would be tellurotic. So let's go with that then. Let me stress that these terms are something I made up myself for our particular purposes and is not something that is used in the scientific community. Let me know in the comments what terms you prefer and if you have any better proposals. Now, there's an interesting twist in that K-type or orange dwarf stars might actually hit the sweet spot of habitability between G-type yellow dwarfs like our Sun and red dwarfs. Though somewhat cooler than our Sun, if hot enough, these may even be more conducive to life. So perhaps it could be useful to distinguish two subtypes, termed chlorogean, denoting the green-yellow light like our Sun's, and xanthogean, denoting yellow-orange light. One thing not yet mentioned is the Earth's moon, which may be the dark horse here. While beneficial in stabilizing Earth's rotation and causing tides that help mix ocean waters and redistribute nutrients, it is unclear whether it's truly indispensable for life to thrive. We could imagine different alternative Earths with no moons, or perhaps several and of varying sizes, and speculate on how that would affect its servants' conditions. Also, an Earth analogue may circle a gas giant itself, which would introduce other interesting dynamics and features, such as stronger tidal forces, complex day-night cycles, and enhanced protection from cosmic radiation, though not the radiation from the host planet itself. The specific effects would depend on factors like the distance to the host planet, its size, and the orbital configuration of the system. An Earth analogue may also orbit binary stars of varying composition and temperature. All in all, there are still plenty of interesting variations to ponder about. In the next video of this series, I will take a look at the possible common stages of development these tellurotic, or just Earth-like, worlds may go through. What variations are possible, how would it affect life, and what would it take for Cambrian explosions to eventually occur? Give us your own thoughts down below in the comments. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up and maybe even a sub if you haven't already. Thanks for sticking around, and till next time, stay sharp and stay evolved.